us with prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the invitation that you've given us, that if we came together in your name, that you'd be here right in the middle of us, so we welcome you this morning. We pray, Lord, that in your presence, that we bring you glory and honor, and that we would be changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first hymn is How Great Thou Art on page 532 of the Lutheran Book of Worship.
Yeah.
inside of the bulletin. Almighty, eternal God, show mercy to your children, who humbly pray that we who have no confidence in our word may not be judged, but tenderly received. Grant us, we pray, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May the peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet God's people with peace. Okay, so I want to remind you that on December 15th, we're having a special outreach for kids and parents and families in general. And there's a couple who do puppet presentations. Diane, what's their names again? Or what's the name of their program?
It doesn't tell you, it just says Puppet and Story Works, a Venting Merry Puppet and Story Christmas.
Okay, so it's Puppet Works, I think, and it should be a good time. It's December 15th at our regular service. We'll have the Word of God and things like that, abbreviated version, and then they'll have the rest of the service. This would be a great day to invite friends, children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and everybody, actually. And
I have two, and I'm going to make more pamphlets if anybody wants to take a pamphlet somewhere.
Right, pass them off, invite your friends, neighbors, your enemies. And let's see, and then I know we have a lot of other announcements in the bulletin for December. The annual congregational meeting is December 1st, and there's a Christmas fellowship meal following that congregational meeting. And then it says a covered dish sign-up sheet is at the entrance of the sanctuary, or will be. Not sure if it's there or not. December 2nd is baking cookies beginning at 8 a.m. Provide Lisa with a list of ingredients with recipes by November 17th. And any other ones that are pressing or any praises?
Today is the last day to order poinsettias. So the order sheet's out of the narthex. You don't have to give me the money today, but do fill out if you do want a flower from the matter.
Okay. How about praises, thanksgiving, some great thing the Lord has done in your life this week that you'd like to share?
I have something. Jessica came home from the hospital on Wednesday, and yesterday she said, I'm actually feeling not too bad.
So I'll give an abbreviated version here because there's people I know here that don't know maybe what's happening. Ron and Mac's daughter Jessica gave part of. Did I say something wrong?
No, that's right.
Okay. Just correct. If I make mistakes, I'll probably just like wave and tell me wrong. So she gave part of her liver to a little boy named Brody, her best friend's kiddo. And praise the Lord, it's working, and we need to continue to pray for Brody. He's like 5 years old and went into liver failure. So we need to keep praying that everything keeps working well. But anyway, praise the Lord for that. Any other prayers?
This reading is taken from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses says, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And And now behold, the cry of the people of Israel have come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, but I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they asked me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever. And thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. Here ends the first reading.
Our psalm is 148. Hallelujah, praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights.
Praise him, all the angels of his. Praise him, all the hosts.
Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars.
Praise him, heaven and heavens, and the waters above the heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created.
He made them steadfast forever and ever. He gave them a law which shall not pass away.
Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps.
Fire and hail, snow and fog, tempest wind and winds of the
mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars.
Wild beasts and all cattle, creeping things and winged birds.
King of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the world.
Young and maidens, old and young together.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name only is exalted. His splendor is over earth and heaven.
He has raised up strength for his people, and grace for all his little servants, the children of Israel, a people who are near to him. Hallelujah.
Our kids, and we have kids here today. Okay, so, if you paid attention to the reading, I know you did, being good, godly children and grandchildren of a preacher, you listened to the Old Testament reading, right? It was about Moses, and he's taking care of the sheep, and he goes out, and he sees a burning bush, and it's amazing because the bush is burning like a huge, I picture it as being this huge, giant flame, right? But nothing is burning up. And Moses looks at it, he's wondering what's going on, so he gets a little closer to check it out. And then out from the burning bush comes a voice that says, Moses! And he's terrified. God is speaking to him from the bush. And it goes on where God says, I've heard the cries of my people. I know about their suffering, and I'm going to set them free. And we didn't read this far into it, but God goes on to say, and I'm going to use you in this process. Now, I just want to give you just a real fast background about Moses. Moses, when you remember him, right? How he was put in the water by his mom because they were killing babies at his time, and his mom put him in the water hoping that somehow he would escape being killed when he was a couple years old. And he's taken by the Pharaoh's house, and the Pharaohs are the ones who are killing the Israelites and making them slaves. So he becomes like an Egyptian. He becomes a big shot, a powerful person. And one day he sees, and inside his heart it burns, that his people are enslaved. He's not enslaved, but his people are. And he desperately wants to change that. And so he gets involved in an argument where an Egyptian is abusing one of his fellow countrymen, and he gets involved and he gets in a fight and he ends up killing the guy. And so for the sake of protecting his people, he kills this man and then he hides his body in the sand and he ends up having to run for his life. He runs for his life and he's way far away from his home and from his people, and he's taking care of his father-in-law's sheep, and God speaks to him and says, I'm going to set my people free, I'm going to use you. So what do you think Moses says? Here I am, Lord, use me. I've always wanted to be a hero. I've always wanted to be used by God. You think that's what he said? Nope, he made a list of excuses. I can't do it, Lord. You don't, I'm not very good at, you know, I don't speak very well. And I don't know if he was making it up or maybe he really did speak good. We don't know. But he gave all these reasons why he couldn't be used by God to save his people. And I noticed something here, and this is what I want you to think about. It's interesting. I think deep down inside of us as God's children, we want to be used by God. We want God to use us to help other people. We want God to use us for who knows what great things. And then when the opportunity comes, inside of us, we start chickening out. Right? We go, I don't really want to. But really, that's a lie. We do want to. And so what God told Moses, when Moses kept making excuse after excuse after excuse about why he couldn't do it, God said, Moses, don't you get it? I made you. You're talking about not being able to speak good? I made your tongue and your lips. Moses, this isn't about you. It's about me and you. See, I'm not sending you alone. I'm not asking you to go do something by yourself, by your own power, your own strength. I will go with you. I will empower you. I will help you. And you know, that is still true today. Right? The word of God says that Jesus is God with us, and the Holy Spirit is God in us. And God still wants us to do things for him. He wants to use us to share his love and his word with those around us. He wants to use us to pray for people. He wants us to use us to testify to people who don't know him, right? He wants to use us. And of course, what happens when we get the chance, there's at least part of us that wants to chicken out. And that's not, that's just normal. That feeling of like, not me and wanting to turn around and run, that's normal. We all face it and all experience it. But here's a good understanding of what being courageous is. Courageous isn't being unafraid. It's just going ahead and trusting God and doing it anyway, even though you are afraid. And so let's remember this, right? Inside of us, we really want to serve God, and we want to make a choice and a decision that says, when God gives me a chance to be used by him, regardless of how small it is, what small service or giant service, I'm going to be used by God, and I'm not going to let myself chicken out. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the example that you gave us in your word of Moses, this great man of God, a great prophet, greatly used by you, but just so ordinary, just a regular guy who's like us, afraid when we get put on the spot, afraid when we have opportunity to be used by you. Thank you, Lord, for not letting him chicken out. Thank you for reminding him that this isn't about what we can do, it's about what you can do in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
The second reading is from 2 Thessalonians. Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to him, and we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind and alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word, or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you in any way, so that they will not come unless the rebellion comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things, and you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time? For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. But we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved, through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. To this he called you through the gospel, so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by our spoken word or by our letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and God the Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort, good hope through grace, comfort your heart and establish them in every good word and work.
Will you stand with me for the reading of the gospel? Gospel according to Luke chapter 20 verses 27 through 40. Then came to Jesus some Sadducees, those who denied that there's a resurrection, and they asked him a question, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies having a wife and children, the the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first took a wife and died without children. The second and the third took her. Likewise, all seven left no children and died. Afterwards, the woman died also. In the resurrection, therefore, whose wife will the woman be? For the seven had her as wife. And Jesus said to them, the sons of this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy to attain to that age and to the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. For they cannot die, because they are equal to angels and are sons of God, being sons of the resurrection. But that the dead are raised, even Moses showed in the passage about the bush, where he calls the Lord the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And he's not God of the dead, but of the living, for all live to him. And some of the scribes answered, Teacher, you have spoken well. For they no longer dared to ask him any question. Excuse me, this is the gospel of the Lord. You can be seated. So we are in a sermon series called God's Amazing Grace and Our Amazing Gracious God. And I would like us to just review a little bit, because I think reviewing is helpful for us. And the first week we talked about God's saving grace, and grace is the heartbeat of the gospel, it's the heartbeat of the Bible. A definition that we're using for the saving grace is the free, unmerited favor of God as demonstrated in the salvation of sinners and the bestowal of his blessings on people. And saving grace is the very foundation of our salvation. Ephesians 2 says, for by grace, verse 8 and 9, for by grace you've been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, is the gift of God. It's not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. And God's grace reaches out to fallen, sinful people, even before they know they need him. Ephesians also says in verse 8, while we are yet sinners, Christ died for us. Saving grace begins working in us even before we know God. Saving grace should always keep us very humble, not just humble, but very humble, because it reminds us, right, that our salvation is all about how good God is, not how good we are. And grace, from last week, grace must be received and applied correctly in order to have effect. So in other words, grace has to be received and applied in faith in order for it to have effect. Grace not received correctly is in vain. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1 and 2 says, as God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. And so last week we talked about our part is to believe and to surrender to God's love and grace through Jesus. His part, God does all the hard part. His part is to wash us from our sins, to breathe life in us, to make us alive to God through his Holy Spirit. And we also used last week, we used Zacchaeus as the example from our gospel reading. And we pointed out that in spite of the fact that he was a wretched sinner, he was a seriously wretched sinner, but he had an interest in knowing God. And I just remind you that sometimes people who don't seem like they have any interest in God, who seem to be living, you know, completely wrong life, that somewhere deep inside of them, they still may have an interest and a thirst in knowing God. And some think that because a person is a wretched sinner, that they're unreachable, uninterested in God. But the same grace that can save us and change us, that same grace can also call the worst sinner to repentance. So we must always be willing to tell people about Jesus. Who knows what great things God may do? God's word says, where sin abounds, grace doth abound even more. Amen? So there's nothing that he can't do. And we noticed in Zacchaeus that he was willing to seek Jesus. He wasn't passive, but he was active in trying to find Jesus. He went out, couldn't see him, but he didn't turn back and leave. Instead, he went and found a tree to climb up so that he could see this one that he'd heard about. He sought Jesus, he heard Jesus, and he believed. And when Jesus called to him, he responded with joy and repentance. And that is, he turned from living his way to living God's way. And his repentance included making changes in the way he lived, the way he worked, and the way he dealt with people. He received the grace of God, and Jesus said, today salvation had come to his house. Now this morning's sermon, part 3, is titled, God's Grace Has Appeared, or we can subtitle it, The Power of God's Transforming Grace. Before we begin 3, let's start. Let's start with prayer. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for its power. Lord, the gift of God, your word, has given to us, Lord, that it could change us and transform us, conform us to your image. So, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, as we consider your word and hear your word, that you would speak by your Holy Spirit and help us apply it to our hearts and our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So a couple of key scriptures to focus on and to think about for this part of the sermon series is Titus chapter 2 and verse 11. You know, it's sort of random, isn't it? Or is it every 15 minutes?
For me, it was turned off. I don't know how it automatically came turned on.
I thought someone was trying to like make sure that I knew when it was 11. So, Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For God has revealed his grace for the salvation of all people. Matthew chapter 4, verse 16. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. Now, we looked at Moses this morning in the Old Testament reading and just considering him as an example, right? God appears to Moses in the middle of this burning bush. It's God who reaches out to Moses. It's God who reaches out and calls him even by his name. And Moses, I think, wanted to meet God, but when the moment came, he was actually quite terrified. And God says how he's seen the affliction and the oppression of his people, and he says, I know they're suffering. And I think we just stop and just, it's a sermon for a different day, but it's an important sentence right there. I know my people suffering, and that's an amazing thing that God knows the suffering of his people. He knows everything that you and I go through. He knows our suffering. He hears what's going on in our lives. And God says to Moses, it's my desire and my intention to bring my people out of captivity, out of slavery and out of bondage. I want to bring them into a new place, a new beginning, a land of salvation, a land of provision. I just want you to consider this idea with me when we look at the Old Testament. Most things in the Old Testament are what's called a type of something that's in the New Testament, like a shadow of what's to come. And so when we look at the whole story of the deliverance of God's people, we can just like, oh, okay, we can see this, right? Israel is God's people. It also includes us today. Egypt is the land of slavery. It's the land of sin. It's the place of sin. It's bondage, and it's a type of lostness. In other words, in today's economy, it's the unsaved. Mankind in bondage. Pharaoh is a type of Satan who tries to keep people enslaved and keep them in the land of sin. The Red Sea, which the people cross to get out, is a type of the blood of Jesus. They go through the Red Sea, and when the Red Sea closes back over, there is nothing that can follow them past the Red Sea. So just as a picture and a type of where God's people have been, God raised up a deliverer, Moses, and the type of Moses is Jesus, right? And he brought us out of the land of slavery, out of the land of darkness, and he brought us to the Red Sea, which is the blood of Christ. And when the red blood of Christ passed back over and wiped out all of Pharaoh's men and army, it's a picture of God saying, I have blotted out your transgressions and your sins. I'll remember no more. In the wilderness that they went into is a type of the journey that we have on earth as we're heading to the promised land of the resurrection day. And the burning bush is a revelation of God's grace. It's speaking out God's very words. And that's what we're talking about is grace appearing. The grace of God has appeared so that people can be saved. From the time, even before I was saved, when I was a little boy, my parents would give me the right foot of fellowship at the Presbyterian Church about four times a year. At least, and they attended themselves every Christmas. And they would send my brother and I, though, to Sunday school several times a year. They wouldn't stay, they would just drop us off. And it was at the Presbyterian Church in a little Sunday school that I heard about Jesus Christ for the first time in my life. And I remember very vividly this teacher telling us about people that didn't know Christ and how terrible it was to live in darkness. And I don't know how old I was, I don't think maybe 10 years old, something like that, 9 years old, something like that. But I heard those words and I thought, what I would like to tell people about Jesus. I would love to be able to tell people who have no chance and no way of knowing, I would love to tell them about Jesus. I had no idea that God had shaped me even from the time I was a little child to be a missionary. But he did. And as I got older and got into trouble in my teen years and walked after my flesh and the ways of the world, those thoughts and those ideas were all forgotten. I was struggling in my life. I was in trouble with my parents and with the law. I ended up spending 18 months in a home for juvenile delinquents for burning down a flour mill. And I was in turmoil emotionally with my father in prison and my mother at home for the mentally ill. And my adopted parents just simply did not know how to deal with us. And then one night, right before I was 18, I was invited to a church service and I heard the good news of Jesus Christ. And all I can say is, wow. When I heard that message of grace, I had a hard time. It seems so incredible that God could be that kind, that gracious, that good, that he would forgive my sins and give me a new life, that he'd breathe inside of me and make me alive. And God's grace was for me. And how precious did that grace appear when I believed. It just was overwhelming to me, that grace that God would give me. And missions, because of that, has always been thrilling to me. The idea, and I don't believe in missions like it's that we have to go overseas to do missions. I think we're all supposed to be on mission, being used by God to allow his grace to come to those around us. But missions has always been thrilling to me, preaching God's great news, that the grace of God would be revealed, that people could have their sins taken away, that they could have a new life, a new beginning, grace to save, grace to heal, grace to deliver, grace to change and transform for all who would receive the gift of God. In Bible college, my main interest was the study of missiology. I loved to hear and learn how great God's grace appeared to people in different places and the changes it brought. And, you know, one of the reasons I say this is sometimes when we're just in the church and we've been worshiping the Lord, we love the Lord, we've been worshiping the Lord a lot of our lives, we just forget sometimes how powerful the grace of God is to save people. And sometimes if we're not careful, we start actually limiting what we think God can do. We start thinking about, well, you know, this is never going to change. This could never change. Listen, God is never in the, it's not like that for God. God's not the never, it can never change God. He's the God that can move a mountain. He's the God that can break a heart that's of stone. So the Lord can do anything. Now, one of the most famous examples in the 20th century of God's grace, and I promise you, I really like missions, and I could give you a lot of examples. But I just picked one that has always moved me. It's the example of God's grace changing not just a person, but an entire culture. It took place in New Guinea, and it was a result of the Holy Spirit working through a missionary by the name of Don Richardson and his family, and the people that he worked with are called the Sawi people. And the Sawi were headhunters, and they were cannibals, and this family arrived in their village. They had a 7-month-old boy, and eventually they had more boys living in this jungle, and this family, for a part of their lives, learned the language, embraced the culture in ways that would shape the rest of their lives, and the life that they chose changed and shaped that culture by God's grace. And if you've never read the story, you can read it. It's called The Peace Child. And when I find one of the boxes that have my books in it, you can borrow it from me. I just don't know what box it's in, but I know I have it. And anyway, their story has inspired an entire new generation to take the gospel to many still unreached people groups in the world. Just for the record, the Richardsons went there in the 60s, but there's still many unreached peoples. And some of them aren't as, like, these people didn't even know what an airplane was. They didn't know anything about they knew nothing about modern world. But there's many people who aren't so remote that still have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ even a single time. Okay, so I have set my video projector up here, and God willing, it's going to work. So Titus, our scripture, remember, is God has revealed his grace for the salvation of all people. In Romans 10, verse 13 and 15 and 17, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard. Now, when I put this together, I think it's rather clever. I hope you do too. I was making a play on the television show Law and Order and how they have their beginning, and so I hope you find it clever. How shall they hear without a preacher? How shall they preach unless they're sent? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. There's the power to transform. That's what God can do. Take us from a caterpillar to a butterfly. You know, those analogies don't always hold up, right? Because butterflies and caterpillars are not the only thing that metamorphosize. Is that the right word? That do the metamorphosis thing. Blowflies do too. But it doesn't have quite the same sounds like, yeah, he was a blowfly, and then he became he was a maggot, and then he became a blowfly. Butterfly is a lot nicer picture.
Evangelism has three separate but essential parts. The Father's part in sending Jesus to save mankind from sin. His followers' part in bringing his word to every tribe and people. And the tribes and the people who receive his word. These are their stories.
Clever, huh? So here's New Guinea right there. A little closer view so you can see where it's at with everything else if you don't know. Close up of it there. So one of the things when we talk about the grace of God appearing is we have to remember, like, when you don't have grace, when people don't have grace, like, our nation has been given grace. So even as a nation, we understand something about good and bad and right and wrong. But imagine a culture where the grace of God simply hasn't appeared yet. They live in, living without God means that they live in darkness. And the Sami people were serious warriors. They were constantly at battle, constantly at war, constantly killing. And they killed not just their own people. I mean, not other people. They even killed their own people. And I want you to have a picture of these, of what happens when people live in darkness, right? Because they lived in darkness and they had no understanding of right and wrong. They had no discipline. They had rage and anger and temper tantrums. And they actually fostered those in their children. Because the idea was that the meanest, the most violent people could be the rulers. And so this meant their children had no respect for parents or others or any kind of authority. And as a culture, they had no respect for life at all, not even among themselves. And interestingly enough, they didn't live very long. They didn't have a very long lifespan. They were constantly at war with some tribe or others. I put on their little things for view. Because it's church. There's a very old picture of them. And that's actually a reenactment from the movie The Peace Child. And they were headhunters. They killed people, took their heads, and then used their heads. They slept on them, thinking that it would bring their power from their soul into them. These people had no morals. They had no discernment in goodness, justice, or righteousness. Okay, that's a reenactment, fortunately, from Peace Child, where they're killing and getting ready to prepare this guy for the cooking pot. Now, when this missionary came to them, he tried to explain the gospel to them, and they had some weird idea in their culture that white people weren't normal, they weren't regular people, and so they received this missionary because they thought that they needed him, that he would bring like a blessing and luck to their warring tribes. And when the missionary, he took the time of learning their language, and then once he learned their language, then he started preaching the gospel to them. And it just was like talking to a rock, and the water would just roll off of a duck's back when they shared the gospel. That's how they did not receive it. And then one time he was getting more and more into the story, and he got into the story where Judas betrays Jesus, and all of a sudden he had their full attention. They were just mesmerized by that. They said, well, tell us that again. We want to hear that again. And so it turns out that they had this ideal in their nation, and it is the idea that you make friends with someone, you invite them to your home, you invite them to your land, you pretend to be their friend, you feed them, you bless them with different things. And then when they've completely believed that you're your friend, that you have love for them, then they stab you in the back, they kill you, and then they eat you. And it's called fattening up with friendship for the unexpected slaughter. Not really as one would fatten a pig, because of the fact that pigs don't get what's happening. So they want that moment where you understand that you have been betrayed, and that they have lied to you, and in that pain, you died, and that was their goal. So when they heard the story of Jesus and Judas betraying him, they thought Judas was the hero of the story. Now you can imagine, like, how do you preach the gospel to someone who gets it so backwards and so mixed up? Well, as they were having war with a tribe, and they were worried that they were literally going to be exterminated because it was a bigger tribe than theirs, a lot more warriors. And in the course of this, they told Don Richardson that there was a way that they could make peace with that other tribe, and that peace would be guaranteed if they exchanged infants between the villages. And that infant that's being traded is called a peace child, and as long as the peace child lived, peace was guaranteed. So the tribes would get together and they would take a child, and oftentimes it was a long process because the father would take the child, he would go bring it to the other tribe, and the mother would run and beat on him and take her child and run. Because nobody wants to give up their child, even for the sake of peace. It's a hard thing to give up. And eventually someone would be willing to sacrifice their innocent baby and bring them to the other tribe, and they would give a baby to them, and peace would be established. It was in this moment that the missionary understood there was a redemptive analogy, a key to unlock the hearts of these people. And he explained to them, it was quite a process, this peace child. The people stood in a line, like with their legs spread like this, and the father had to go underneath those legs and bring that child through, like going through a birth canal, into the other tribe. And when Don Richardson explained that God has done the same thing, he's provided a peace child, Jesus Christ. God was willing to give up his only son, and was willing not just to give him to another tribe, but to actually give him to die, to suffer, and to be crucified. And in that moment, when they understood it, grace appeared to them. There they are, and I must not have audio of that. They were bringing the peace child through there. And when the grace of God appeared, it brought salvation and transformation. Jesus, the peace child, came to those people and transformed them almost overnight. Instead of warring with their neighbors, they built the largest bamboo dome church in the world. I'm not sure that anyone ever set out to build the biggest dome, bamboo dome in the world prior to this, but it's quite an accomplishment, especially since their goal was that they could invite all villages who they formerly warred with, that they could come together and hear the gospel, and they could worship God the Father and the Creator of heaven and earth. And you can imagine it was a hard sell. Right? When they went to the other tribe and said, hey, we want to invite you to a service. We got a great service. We want you to come and hear about Jesus and who can save your souls. And they went, yeah, we know about you people. And then you're going to do us in afterwards, right? And it must have taken a while for them to convince people. And what a transformation when people realized that God had done this great work in them. Once they were ruled by distrust and treachery and murder, it was replaced by brotherhood and fellowship, true friendship and love. And the village, their value of life can change completely. Instead of seeing life as worthless, they began to realize that life is valuable because all people are made in God's image. Cannibalism, headhunting were put away with all the other sinful practices of their former life. New life, abundant life, and eternal life had come to them. Instead of teaching rebellion and hatred to their children, families submitted themselves to God's word, and they prayed for their enemies. Now, not long ago, in the last few years, Don Richardson and three of his sons returned to the Sawi to visit them after all these years, exactly 50 years from the time that they first arrived. And they were received with a hero's welcome. They saw friends they knew from long ago. And one of the things that Don Richardson said was, it's amazing to see so many old people, because there didn't used to be any old people because of their lack of value of life. But now that Christ had come to them, they lived in peace. And the gospel that took root 50 years ago is still holding those people today. He who began a good work among the Sabbath has been faithful to complete it, Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. Here's Don Richardson, they're baptizing a bunch of people. These are these formerly terrifying headhunters coming to church service, baptisms, conferences, to worship the Lord. Jesus has come to give light to those who sin in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. God's grace is amazing. He loves people and he reaches out to them and he sends us to share his love and his life, his word, to preach the gospel with our lives, our actions. It's God's word is the grace that appears now. What amazing power his gospel has to change lives, and not just the lives of headhunting cannibals. The lives and the hearts of people everywhere, power to change the lives of those around us who live in darkness. The grace of God has appeared, and it brings salvation. And I don't know about you, but I love God's grace. It's amazing, beautiful, merciful grace. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Lord, I know this is just one story out of millions, Lord, of people's lives when you change cultures and places and people, Lord, where your light has come and changed people from the inside out. And Lord, we're thirsty to see that grace at work, Lord, in our area, in our county, Lord, in this state, Lord, in our nation. Lord, we want to see that grace, Lord, just abound. And we ask in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would remember, Lord, our neighbors, our friends, and our family, Lord. Let your grace come, Lord, with great power. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would use us in the process, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Our hymn is number 305, I Lay My Sins on Jesus, in the Lutheran Book of Worship. accept these gifts, and with them our lives be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their needs. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious Father, we lift up to you all in need of your healing touch. We especially pray for Robin, Armel, Doc Wilkins' family, Xander Nguyen, Lois, Peggy, Polly, Joyce, Magnona, Betty and Judy, Rudy, Jessica, Robin, Audrey Eisenhower, Grace Coleman, Eddie Campbell Jr., and those whose names we now call out to you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we lift up to you all who are part of our church family, that are in care centers, nursing homes, and ask you to give them a sense of your presence and peace that goes beyond circumstances. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up to your nation and our leaders. Grant wisdom that they may lead according to your will. Lord, we ask that the revival, spiritual renewal, and repentance would sweep our nation and turn the hearts of our people back to you. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for all those who are serving in our country and military and as soldiers. Especially we pray for Nathan, Matt, Kyle, Jeffrey. We ask that you guard, protect, and bless them in your work. Lord, in their work. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Father, we hold before you all who are suffering persecution, imprisonment, loss, and suffering for your name's sake throughout the world. Deliver them, grant them grace to endure, your power to remain faithful. Pour out your peace on them and their families. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, merciful Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray then the prayer the Lord has given us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. No dismissal, just a commission. Go and be about the Father's business, were his hands to reach out to those around us, were his lips to speak the word that he wants to speak. So be on mission, look for opportunities to encourage those who are discouraged. Look for opportunities to pray for the people who need prayer. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you and your household great peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is number 444, I Love to Tell the Story.
Thank you.